effectively answer it in a proper way after today's seminar.
Recording in progress.
Our keynote speakers will present their speeches either in English or in Chinese. Again, because of time, please excuse us for not providing on-site translation service. Also, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Dragon Eagle TV for providing us technical support to this seminar. So first, let's welcome Cook County Sheriff Office, Thomas, Mr. Thomas Dodd, to give a welcome remark. Dodd, please.
Hey, thank you so much for having me with you again tonight. I'm so sorry about everything that's been going on in the community, and we just want people to get the message from us on two levels. One, that we are here to help and that things will get better. They will. We just have to work together on multiple things we can do together. I could sit here and talk forever about, you know, how it all individuals who have concerns that are focused on violence, on just the violence issue. I'm going to have someone from my office who will be speaking after me about that issue. I'll have someone speaking about hate crime related issues as well. I just wanted to let you know that our assistance is broad. It's not a narrow thing. We're only helping in areas. We can help in many, many areas. And so I have the ability to work anywhere in the county of Cook, which includes Chicago and anywhere else and the other suburbs. We work routinely with the police department and other police departments all throughout the county, and we will continue to do that. But what I need your community to understand is that anything you might have concerns-wise as regards to crime could be of great help to you on many levels. So in the area of, say, for example, a hotline that we put together years ago, it's a very viable place and a location for people to go to report hate crimes and to have a response made to you immediately. This isn't something where you're going to get a recorded message. There'll be a live person who will talk to you about whatever the incident may be. And even if you've already talked to another police department and you still have some open questions, you can reach out to us as well. We also have something that we've been doing in other areas of the county where we teach people self-defense, where we come out, you bring an organization together, and we will teach you defensive tactics. So you yourself will maybe feel a little bit better as you're walking down the street, as you're going to work, as you're going to the store. All of those things are things that we can do. But the other part of it that I want to mention to you was this broader thing that our office would be happy to do. If your community is having any special events, they're having areas where they have unique issues with security or unique issues with crime, please reach out to us. We can't be all things to all people, but I can tell you in many other communities, whether it's frankly the Jewish community, the Muslim community, when they have unique events, we can put additional police. So if you have a local police department that's already helping, we can add additional police there as well. Or if it's something where you have a routine event that goes on, it may be a community center, and you'd just like to have a car drop by occasionally just so people feel more at ease, we can do that as well. Or if there's just an area that's having a spike in crime, we will work with the local police department, whatever that entity might be, to see if there's ways that we can help as well. As I mentioned, our resources, like everyone else, is limited, but we just have the ability to help in a lot of areas. We just need to have the connection with you and individuals articulate to us what it is that you need to do. And once again, we'd be happy to come out, meet with individuals, meet with larger groups to lay out all the different things that we can do. But any way you cut it, we can be a great help. It's just a connection, a question of us making that connection. So we've been working with so many different leaders in your community over the last year or so, particularly Michelle Shang and others. So we have the ability to get a hold of each other. Michelle can call me 24 hours, and she has if she needs me. Many other people have the ability to call me personally just if they need any help. But beyond that, within my office itself, we have individuals who are specifically devoted to this issue and the issues of crime, obviously, as well. So we're there to help. We're very well trained, and we're very happy to help on many, many levels. It's just a question of you reaching out to us, and we can do, and we can help, and we can also provide peace of mind for people as well. So please, 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 don't give up. Don't feel that things are so bad that we can't come out of this and come up with some solutions. There's things that we can do, and we can actively work together, and we can do that. So please, I've talked longer than I wanted to. I just wanted to give you a general idea of our office and what we can do. But please, I have two different members of my office. Tisa Morris will be on the call. She's on there right now. If you have any questions about self-defense courses or anything along those lines. And then I have another gentleman, Arunas, who's going to be speaking as well about crime and prosecutions. He's a former prosecutor, just like me. I'm sheriff now, but I used to be a state's attorney many years ago, and Arunas was as well. So we have the ability to talk not only about arresting people, but also the prosecution side as well. So once again, please, 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 whatever we can do to help, we are there for you. And thank you so much for having me in my office participate.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Thomas. Next, Ms. Jen Zhen, the president of Chinese American Association at Greater Chicago, will present her speech.
Well, thank you, Sheriff, very much. And thank you for your office participation for tonight's seminar, and welcome everyone. I saw right at 7:30, we already have 1,000 participants. That means our community really care and really pay attention to the safety issues in our community. And welcome to our seminar. My name is Jan Zhen, president of Chinese American Association Greater Chicago. On November 9th, a 24-year-old UC student, Dennis Zhen, was shot on the University of Chicago campus during the daylight. And this incident was the third violent crime involving a UC student this year. During the past 12 months, three robbery murder cases happened in Chicago Chinatown, and innocent life was taken away and family broken apart forever. The Chinese community here in Chicago is sad and horrified. It can happen to any of us. The statistic released by the Chicago Police Department shows that so far in 2021, 678 people in Chicago have been murdered, which is much higher than the past 3 years. And the number of shooting victims in Chicago has also gone up compared to last 3 years. People are literally scared. They're telling the family members to stay in and stay away. And tonight, our community is asking what to do during violent crimes and how to protect themselves and what are the prevention efforts in government and schools will be put in place. We really appreciate the Cook County Sheriff's Office and also from the University of Chicago, the Safety and Security Officer here to give us some guidance on how to protect ourselves during the random violence and what to do. And also the policy put in place. We appreciate all the people's, our co-host for putting together tonight's event. And we're looking forward to work with everyone in fighting crimes and make Chicago a better home for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, President Zhen. Our next speaker is Mr. Stanley Zhou. He is the president of the Association of Chinese American Scientists and Engineers.
Thanks, sir. Thank you. And the honorable guests and the moderators, speakers, and the friends, good evening. My name is Stanley Zhou, and the president of the Chinese Association of Chinese American Science and Engineers. First of all, welcome everyone attending this event, and thanks to all the moderator or speakers spending the time and prepare this event. Last week, we heard the bad news from the Chinese student from the UC and was killed on the street. Was shocked. We have the meeting together and see what we can do to help the community. We come with the idea with the seminars, how to prevention measures and how to see the crime pattern, so on and so forth. So finally, we decide we have one to run the seminars. In the meantime, Mr. Zhang and also call me, they say, there are so many initiatives and we want to work together. So that's why the reason we prepare today's event. And we'll then also invite the sheriff's office. We have not able to reach and also present their expertise and their advice. I think that's very, very good and very informational seminars. Because we have put it, we speak, let us keep us silent for 10 seconds and to memorize an assumption. Thank you. Assumption is very, very smart and hardworking and has lots of dreams, but his journey the end on the street of the Chicago. That's very sad news. I read a lot of the background, the papers about the family, his parents, his mother, and raised him. And he studied in Hong Kong. So it's really sad. As Zen said, this is the third case. And UC students was killed this year. Chicago is become very bad. So we need to see what we should do. So we propose a couple of things. First one, we need to urge all the government and especially police department, put the resources and put safety measures in place, protect the people. We don't need more killings. Enough is enough. Second, we need to mobilize all the Chinese community, or even all the people in Chicago. We need to work together, make a phone call to your congressman and to all the local government. We need to really need to take a serious and put the resource into place and solve our concerns. Third, and we want also want you to get to practice some the advice. How can deal with it? If you're in the case, when you run into those violent crime situation like this, how can you handle the things? I think those the questions we can answer for today's seminars. Thank you much. Welcome to seminar.
Thank you, Stanley, for your speech. Our next speaker will be Mrs. Ran Li. She is the president of the United Chinese American Association Illinois chapter.
Thank you, Mr. Wang. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the virtual seminar again. I want to thank everyone for taking the time to join us for this event and to participate in today's discussion. I want to take this good opportunity to thank Sheriff Dart, Jen, and Stanley. I want to thank Cook County Sheriff Office, University of Chicago, the Chinese American Association of Great Chicago, and the Association of Chinese American Scientists and Engineers for collaborating with us, United Chinese American Illinois Chapter, to co-organize this event. I also want to especially thank our keynote speakers today, Director Aranas and Commander Marcellus and Attorney Huang. Like many of other organizations here today, UCA Illinois has been an advocate presence and voices in both in Chicago and Chinese American communities. Given the recent tragedies, many of us are experiencing deep sadness, loss, and grief. We want you to know that we are here for you and with you, and we care about the increasing safety in our neighborhoods. We see it as our responsibility, everyone's here today's responsibility to respond to these issues by working together about the ways that we can keep ourselves, each other, and all the families and friends safe. So today's talk is one of the first steps that we can take in increasing awareness, protection, and safety in the community. So my hope, the discussion like this will keep us united and engaged together during this tragic and challenging times. And I want to thank everyone again for joining us today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ren. Okay, now our keynote speakers will present their speeches. Okay, and the first keynote speaker is Ms. Arunas Bontinas. He is the priest director of the Cook County Sheriff's Office.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Like I said, my name is Arunas Bontinas. I work for the Cook County Sheriff's Police. I'm a director here. And prior to joining the sheriff's office, I was a prosecutor for 23 years here in the county. So today, what I'd like to present and discuss with you are some practical safety tips, just in terms of protecting yourself from becoming a victim of a crime. And I'd also like to go through the hate crime statute and some of the provisions within that statute that impact your community. So when we're talking about safety, excuse me, let me scare it for me. We're talking about the safety tips. One of the key things for citizens and people out there to remember is they have this situational awareness of their surroundings, because you know the perpetrators of these crimes choose the time to commit the crimes, choose the place, and choose their victims. And so oftentimes when they're looking at this, they're looking at putting themselves to having the most advantage in going in and committing these crimes. And for those victims who can be surprised, can be come up upon and they're able to commit the crimes, that the key would be to have the situational awareness to the threats that are around you, and being able to pay attention to those threats and avoid those situations that could leave you vulnerable to being a victim of a particular crime. So when we're looking at this, I often kind of use this color code of awareness model, and to kind of look at our ability to go in and perceive the environment around us, being able to recognize those threats, and having a plan ready to go in and avoid those threats and be able to be safe. So the first in this color code awareness model, I'd like to talk about is it's called condition green. And that's where, you know, many people out in the community are operating in this condition green, where they're not aware of their surroundings. Oftentimes that you know they may be walking or you know in the park, and they're looking 3 feet ahead of them. And you know you may have someone that maybe a friend or a family member will come upon them, and you know they notice them only when the person is immediately there. Or a stranger maybe asking for directions. And so they're not aware of their surroundings. And so that's not the condition we want to be in. We want to be in a position where we're able to go in and be aware of our surroundings, but not be in a condition where we're fearful of everything that may, you know, kind of fearing that everything may be a potential danger. And so when looking at this, you know, when you're out in public, there's no threat. You should be looking at this condition yellow, which would be kind of a relaxed alertness. And so you're aware of your surroundings. There's no specific threat to you, but you're alert to the possibility that there may be a threat. And so you're noticing things, let's say like walking down the street, notice that this vehicle has passed you twice, or that maybe that you're in a, you may maybe notice that there's a group of people out in front of a store or an elderly couple in front of you. And so you're aware of what's happening around you within your environment. And so it's not only just the people and maybe vehicles, but you're also aware of your particular environment as to where you're at, just, you know, in terms of being aware, you know, those areas that are not as well lit, or, you know, that are kind of secluded, but we're going to be keeping aware of our surroundings and being able to assess those particular and any sort of particular threat, you know. So going in you know, I would kind of have that look at as kind of a focused awareness, focused alertness, and that you're being able to go in and identify any sort of potential threats to you. So where you notice that there may be a potential threat, you move to this, the next level would be condition orange, where, you know, that threat may be a real one or a threat that, that could be perceived. But you're going to have a specific point of focus. So let's say you're in a parking lot or, you know, in a store, and you notice that there's a person leaning up against the wall and they're not going to their car and they're not going to the store. And at that point, you're going to be moved to this, you know, more focused, more alert, focused on that particular threat. And so you should be thinking of, well, you know, that have a plan in mind that if the person comes in and becomes a real threat, you have a plan in your mind to address that threat and escape safely. So, you know, a trigger may be that you're walking in the parking garage and you notice someone leaning up against the wall, and the trigger would be that, well, maybe if they get off the wall and take steps for you, towards you, that you already have a plan in mind, a route to escape, to call 911, yell for help, run to a store that is open, and that you have you have that plan already in place prior to that threat, or prior to being in the middle of that threat.
我进来了，在这看。
Once you ended up having that particular, you know, that trigger event, that mental trigger, that sanity line where someone has crossed that, whether they've taken two steps towards you, or let's say you're driving in a vehicle and you're at a stoplight and you notice that the people in the car behind you have exited the car and are approaching your car, you've already noticed this and have come up with a plan to address it. And then condition red is where you, you know, where that threat is real and you have the plan in mind and you take action. So, you know, things that that having that awareness, you know, being able to walk, make eye contact, be aware of your surroundings, the perpetrator, the person, you know, that may be looking to commit a crime, realizes that the person is alert, is aware of me, and they may choose to go in and select another victim that may not be aware of their surroundings and being able to surprise them. So going through some particular safety tips, you know, that you're always gonna wanna reduce your opportunities to become a victim. You're gonna look at, you know, being aware of your surroundings, being able to avoid those situations that make you more vulnerable to being a victim. You're gonna wanna trust your instincts. So if something doesn't look right, doesn't feel right, that your instincts are probably gonna be right and you should avoid those situations. And just as a daily matter, going in and preparing your planning your day, you should go in and be able to have safety in mind in the plans that you make. So let's look at robbery. And I know that, you know, some of these cases that were in the news recently and it certainly have impacted your community, that they start out as robberies. And so most people who commit robberies are looking to take property, cash or property or valuables from you. And, you know, so certainly in those situations where, you know, they're forcibly taking that property from you, you're going to give that property to them. You know, because you look at, is there any amount of money or any personal item that's worth your life? And so you're going to go in and those situations where you're being robbed, you're going to give up the property and then look to, you know, a safe escape route and to call the police immediately. You should make an effort to kind of walk or travel in groups. So you're going to walk and travel in groups, looking at, you know, being aware of your surroundings, maintaining that eye contact. And so the thieves, you know, the perpetrators can be looking at individuals who aren't aware of them. So they're going to be able to surprise them and be a better victim. So where the perpetrator realizes that you're aware of their presence, they may choose to go in and choose to victimize someone else. You know, they when it comes to walking to your car or walking home, I don't think, you know, don't be afraid or shy to ask someone to walk with you, walk to your car or walk home. You know, when we talked about that situational awareness, we should be looking at avoiding places that are, you know, that at night that are lit or that are isolated. You know, when it comes to your personal items, when we're around in public, you should avoid, you know, wearing expensive jewelry, watches or handbags or displaying cash, you know, so the potential offender is not going to be attracted to, you know, something that may be expensive jewelry, watches, cell phone, or the like. When walking, you know, to and from, you know, maybe your car or walking home, that you're always going to want to have one hand free. So if you're carrying something, a briefcase, you're going to avoid, you know, having carrying things in both hands. You get one hand free to go in and protect yourself. Those situations where you are, you know, walking home or walking to your car. So prior to you coming up to your house, you should have your keys ready or your fob ready for the vehicle. And in those situations where you feel that, you know, perhaps someone is following you and that you're in danger, that you're going to go to the nearest open store or business. You know, certainly, you know, you're not going to have a police station on every corner, but you're going to go to some public place where there are other people there. When we're talking about, you know, many of these robberies, the what they're looking for is the, you know, person's cell phone. And, you know, the cell phones are expensive. So when we're walking, you know, or walking our car or walking home or walking on the street, we're going to be looking at avoiding, you know, texting or avoiding being on your phone, being alert to your surroundings. You know, the cell phone, when you're not using it, you should put it in your pocket or put it in your purse or your briefcase. So, you know, the offender will not fixate on, oh, that's an expensive phone that I want. And you're going to go in and be able to, you know, to not have that in your hand or displayed on a case or on your belt. Looking at the recently over the past couple of years, the spikes in carjacking or vehicular hijacking, you know, that you know, certainly that when you're driving, again, being that situational awareness, being able to, you know, be aware of your surroundings, looking for possible threats, and then where, you know, you end up where there, you know, there is a possible threat that you've identified, maybe someone's following you home, that you're going to go in and you know, maybe take evasive action, maybe turn down the street, take a right, go and go left down the street. And if the person is following you, you're going to go in and immediately go into that mode where you're going to have that triggering event, you know, mental triggering event where if I'm going to come to the intersection, I have to stop, they get out of the car, I'm going to take evasive action, call 911, drive to the police station. So when we're driving, we're always going to be looking at where we're moving in traffic and we have to stop. We're going to leave enough space in front of us, to the car ahead of us, so we're going to be able to take evasive maneuvers, going to be able to go around the car and escape, you know, in any sort of attempted carjacking. You know, so when we look at where carjackings occur, they're going to be in those places where the vehicle slows down or stops. So things like driveways, parking lots, garages, ATMs, shopping centers, intersections. So, you know, when we're in those areas and we're in our car or we're just sitting in our car parked, that we're going to be aware of what's happening around us and be able to you know, think about, you know, if a threat comes up, you know, that I may have a plan to escape to a place of safety and call 911. So when parking your car, you're going to be aware of that area where, you know, there may be people loitering, people around, you may not want to park in that spot. When you exit your vehicle, the window should be up, and that immediately when you exit, you should have should be able to lock your car. And again, we talked about, you know, having that, maintaining that distance, that you have that ability to maneuver your vehicle in the event that there is some sort of threat that comes on you. You're able to safely escape. When we talk about ride sharing, you know, for those of you that use a ride share service, that you're going to wait for your ride share indoors, and you're going to, with the ride share apps, they'll give you the type of vehicle that's picking up, the license plate, one of the first things you're going to verify the license plate, verify the vehicle. And the first thing you're going to ask your driver before even getting into the vehicle, ask them their name. So the ride sharing service will give you your driver's name, and you're going to verify his name by asking their name and verify that you have the right car. So once you've gotten into the vehicle, certainly the driver is going to be responsible for the route, but you're going to want to know the route, and you're going to want to know where you're at when you're traveling. So in the event that that there is an attempted carjacking, you're going to be able to know where you're at and know where a potential areas of safety are. The other thing is you're going to want to inform either your family or friends that you are taking a rideshare service that should be home in 10 minutes and have your friends and family aware of where you're at and where you're going when you're using any sort of ride sharing service. Do you want to switch gears and talk a little bit about hate crimes? So for those perpetrators that end up committing a crime where their motivating factor or one of the motivating factors is the person's race, color, creed, religion, ancestry, gender, sexual orientation, physical or mental disability, or national origin, that if that crime is motivated by those factors, that the case becomes a hate crime. And oftentimes it's going to be more serious than perhaps the original crime. So for example, if there's someone damages property by graffiti or breaking a window, that case may be a misdemeanor. But in those situations where the crime is motivated by race, color, creed, religion, national origin, that case becomes a felony. And so it's important that that in those situations where you do have that the crime occurred, that you're going to report it. So whether you go to your local police department, report it. We here at the sheriff's office have a hotline that you're able to go in and if there's any sort of assistance and any sort of hate crime, that we're going to be able to assist the department and assist you, kind of walk you through the criminal justice system as the case is reported and individuals are apprehended and the case goes to court. Okay. Well, thank you for your attention, and I welcome any questions at the end if anyone has any with regard to safety tips or the hate crime statute or anything that our office does. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. I think your speech has provided very informative safety tips. Now I got a couple of questions to be forwarded to you from our audience. The first question I would like to ask is that person asked you because he actually lives in Philadelphia. So because yesterday some Chinese high school students were attacked on the subway. So that person's question is how the kids can protect themselves if they have to use a public transportation.
Sure. The tips we talked about is teaching your children to be aware of those of their surroundings, to avoid situations on public transportation. So if you're traveling on public transportation, as opposed to sitting into maybe a secluded area of that, whether it's a bus or a train, that you're going to go in and maybe sit closer to the driver, or sit next to a group of people, as opposed to sitting by yourself. which, you know, kind of isolates you and, you know, potentially be a victim of a crime. Certainly being able to know where they're at as they're traveling that public transportation, and then, you know, being ready to where the, you know, the threat is identified, to be able to notify the driver of that, you know, whether it's a bus driver or the train conductor, and being able to call 911.
Okay, thank you. Okay, the next question is about violence taking place at a school. So facing violence at a school, what should be done as schools don't allow students fight back, even as self-defense, you know, so how to deal with this kind of a situation?
Sure. So if it's a fellow student that is, you know, perhaps assaulting or battering another student, you know, immediately the first thing that should be done is to break contact and go seek help from an adult. So an employee of the school, break contact, go in and, you know, yell for help and seek for an adult, or if the child is not able to do so, to ask other students to notify the staff that there is an assault happening or some sort of attack, that they notify an adult. And again, the first thing that should be done is to break contact with that person and go to a safe location and notify an adult.
Okay, thank you. One more question is about the self-defense items. Several people actually asked the same question. So do we need any certificate, okay, to bring, you know, the self-defense items with us?
Sure. So when it comes to self-defense items, so kind of a wide range of items that can be used in self-defense. So with regard to, let's say, a handgun, depending, I know there's people on here from different states, but in Illinois, that you can use a handgun to protect yourself if you have a concealed carry license. And so with that concealed carry license, you're required to attend 16 hours of training and be able to demonstrate marksmanship skills and be able to handle the gun safely. So a firearm is one self-defense item. With regard to that, you know, other states, all 50 states will have some sort of mechanism or some sort of licensing regime to go in and get training and be licensed and certified to carry that particular handgun. Looking at a taser in Illinois, you can own a taser with a FOID card, a firearms owner identification card, and you're able to carry that taser on or about your person with that firearm ownership identification card. And so those situations, you know, those people that are in other states, that they should check with the state as to what is allowed and what is not allowed. And so looking at other items like a mace or pepper spray, are certainly things that that can be used to defend yourself. Getting a whistle or like an alarm that can go in, alert people that if you're in distress, is certainly another option. And then certainly, you know, not even talking about weapons, but going in and going through defensive tactics training, that you're able to go in and with or without a weapon, you're able to go in and know those techniques to defend yourself.
Very good, very instructive. So we got actually lots more questions for you to answer, but I think because of time, I think in the future, if we forward the questions to you, hopefully then we will get answers from you collectively.
Would that be okay?
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. So now I would like to invite our second keynote speaker, that is Mrs. Maceras. She actually is the police commander from University of Chicago.
Good evening and good morning, depending on where you are. I want to say thank you for allowing me the opportunity to speak about safety on behalf of the University of Chicago Police Department. First and foremost, I want to acknowledge the tragic loss of Dennis Zing. I was at his memorial services yesterday. It's very, very sad. And everyone is affected when one of our students is the victim of violence. You know, I plan on being at every court date and standing by him and his trial while his family cannot be here. So I take that very personally, and we take the safety of our faculty, staff, and students at the University of Chicago very safely. The leaders at the University of Chicago Police Department and the University of Chicago are working with the Chicago Police Department on new initiatives pertaining to safety and security. So I wanted to take a moment to answer your questions about what to do during a robbery, how to protect yourself from street violence, and what prevention efforts are in place. Director Wentis did an amazing job. A lot of what you're going to hear is going to kind of sound repeated, but that's important because the message is pretty much the same, you know, across the board. So to reiterate some of the things that Director Wentis said, the most important tip is to use good judgment. And when I mean good judgment, what I'm saying is you have to stay alert. You have to have that situational awareness. So focusing on what's going on around you and eliminating all distractions. What we see most on campus are students walking around with their cell phone in their hand or personal electronic devices, the earbuds, and that's not allowing them to pay attention to what's happening around them or about the people that are around them. It's also really important to plan your route. So if you're traveling in the city, you want to know when the last train arrives. If you're using the UChicago shuttle services, you want to know the times and the routes. You want to have the app on your phone so that you could see if there's any delays in transportation. We also offer free Lyft services to students. So making sure that we're utilizing those transportation options that are available. And also on campus, we have emergency phones, which are white boxes. And in those boxes are cameras, and there's a red button. So those are placed through campus and throughout our extended patrol jurisdiction within our campus community. And if you hit that button, it will directly contact you to our dispatchers, and it'll also start recording, and an officer will be sent directly to your location. It's also important, like Director Buente said, if you're traveling by foot, you know, making sure that you're walking in groups, that you're using routes and that you know the route to where you're going, and that it's highly lit, that the street lights are on, that you know where you are, you know, places that are open depending on the time that you're leaving. So if something does happen, you have a safe place to go. Also, if you see suspicious activity or anything that makes you feel uncomfortable, that you're immediately notifying the police, either by one of the emergency phones, if you're on campus or in our community, or by contacting the police. There's also several safety apps, which I'll talk a little bit later when I'm talking about our services, but using those safety apps that you can just hit an icon and it will directly contact you, the police. If you are the victim of a robbery, do not take any action that will jeopardize your safety or the safety of others. If somebody is demanding your property, give them your property. Property is replaceable. You are not. So make sure that, you know, that somebody is demanding something of you, you know, that you just hand it over to them. You know, also, as mentioned, if you want to carry a whistle or some kind of personal alarm, when you blow that whistle or you activate that alarm, the attention that creates, and most times the offender or the suspect is going to run away. They do not want any additional attention alerted to them. And it also will then alert other people that somebody else may need help, or the area that where you are and that help is needed. You also want to observe the physical characteristics of the offender so that when it is safe, you can report that information to the police, because that helps us when we're monitoring cameras or license plate readers if we have a description of what that person may look like. Some additional safety tips, kind of as mentioned, don't carry large sums of money with you, you know, when you're traveling. If you're using ATMs, try not to use them at night or when there's no other people are around. A lot of times when people are victimized, they're by themselves. There are instances, of course, we know that it happens when there are people around, but in most instances, it's when somebody's around and it seems like they're not paying attention to what's happening. You want to put away your cell phone, your headphones, other valuables. If you're wearing jewelry, you want to make sure that that's concealed. And as mentioned, make sure that you're not overburdening yourself with bags. You want to make sure that you have your hands available. So if you're carrying groceries or book bags or other types of property, make sure that you at least have one hand available, you know, to either contact the police, to wait for help, to defend yourself if you need to. So we want to make sure that we're keeping that open. And then also, as mentioned, making sure that we're walking the well-lit areas. If there's an area that's not lit, the department that you, the city that you live in, they have workers that are responsible for making sure that the lights are fixed and that there's appropriate lighting so that people are safe. Also, some safety initiatives and resources at UChicago. We have a full service police department. So we have 100 officers that are completely Illinois state certified, just as any other police agency in the state of Illinois. We also support the Chicago Police Department in our extended area where they also proactively patrol. We have campus safety ambassadors, which are like security officers that are on foot and in vehicles on campus and off campus, kind of providing that extra eyes and ears for police officers. We have over 380 emergency phones that are equipped with surveillance cameras, and those are on and off campus. We also have LPR systems, which are license plate readers, and those can give us the plates of vehicles that are used to commit crimes, and also additional security cameras that are around campus. We have safety education presentations. So any person, any unit, or any group can ask to have a safety presentation, and we go into great detail about the services and resources available at UChicago for safety. We also have officers that are instructors in self-defense classes. So any student staff can sign up for self-defense classes, which contains classroom instruction through PowerPoint and then also hands-on instruction where you learn how to defend yourself. We also have the safety escort program, which I encourage everybody to use, either our officers, our community service officers, our campus safety ambassadors will provide a safety escort to anybody who requests it. So if you have to walk from one location to another, whether it's during the day, whether it's at night, or you're just not comfortable, somebody will come and follow you to your location to make sure that you get there safely. I also encourage everybody who's at least within our area, and I know it doesn't pertain to everybody in our group, but to download the UChicago Safe app. It's a safe app, it's free to download, and it's got several resources available by just hitting the tap of an icon. If I have that application and my friend has that application, we could actually watch each other go from one location to another or family member to make sure that that person arrives safely. We also have the day and nighttime shuttle services, which are services that are provided to our students, campus, community to go throughout our area. There's also CTA buses. And then we also have the partnership with Lyft. And then also most recently, the university launched a new website with educational materials and recommendations about staying safe in an urban environment. The city of Chicago has 77 different neighborhoods, and that safety and security could change depending on what block you're on. So it provides resources on how to stay safe in the city, around campus, where you live, where you work, and also about transportation. So if anybody has any questions, you know, at this time, I'd be glad to answer, you know, anything that you may have about safety at the University of Chicago.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Janelle. Got a couple of questions. One question is, if crime takes place on campus, so then the victim actually has already, you know, takes kind of a defense measure. And then to which degree the victim can defend himself or herself?
Like Director Puente said, the campus is... no firearms, even with the carry and conceal. So you want to make sure that you have, you know where you are and you can contact the police, but you can carry tasers in the state of Illinois, you can carry OC spray, whistles, and then self-defend yourself. So if you feel that you're at great bodily harm or death, you can defend yourself, you know, up to death. I mean, that's how the statute is written. So anything that you need to do to protect yourself, you're able to do.
Okay, thank you. Then the other question is about the safety map. Do you have a map to tell people to avoid some dangerous areas?
So we patrol our extended patrol jurisdiction, and we have two law enforcement agencies that are in there. We have students, faculty, staff that live everywhere within our extended patrol jurisdiction, and we provide a safe environment for that. So we don't have... there's not areas that we say not to go. I mean, we just want people to know and are educated on the services that we provide. So if they don't feel safe, they feel comfortable utilizing those services.
Okay, thank you. So surely there are still lots of other questions. Then because of time, then I think I needed to give the podium to my colleague, okay, Ms. Lee. So please just take the podium, then I will take a rest. Thank you.
大家好早晨在国内的朋友早晨好，在美国的朋友晚上好。我呢叫李小静，是美国科学家工程师专业人士协会的副会长。今天呢由我来为大家主持下半段中文的讲座。今天呢我们有幸的邀请到了黄正东大律师作为今天的讲座嘉宾。黄律师呢是一位非常优秀的律师和学者，他有30多年的法律实践经验。同时呢，黄律师一直是特别热心我们的公益事业，贡献了很多个人的时间为亚裔社区做义务法律宣传和讲座，免费的为多个华人公益社团作为法律顾问。那黄律师呢，曾经被4次命名为伊利诺伊超级大律师。黄律师呢，今天呢会为我们分析总结一些降低风险、应对犯罪的办法。希望大家呢，欢迎大家在对话框里呢积极提问。那好的，我们现在有请黄律师开始他的发言。
谢谢李小静，谢谢汪理事长。我是黄正东律师，大家好。刚才几位嘉宾呢，主讲嘉宾都用英文讲了，对吧？都用英文讲的，我呢现在用中文讲。我呢，首先啊，我就讲一讲今天呢、今天郑少雄案呢、开庭的实况一个报告。今天上午是11点钟，我们中部时间11点钟，针对郑少雄枪击案，他的凶手名字叫 Alton Spann 的第二次庭审在这个 Cook County 啊，他的 Circuit Court， 他是通过线上 Zoom 对吧进行。我和胡一伦律师作为受害人家属的援助律师，我们呢被特许啊进了这个法庭，因为他这个法庭呢是开放，但是呢就是进法庭呢。直接看到法官呢、还是大部分不允许的。驻芝加哥总领馆张军鹏领事也参加了旁听庭审。庭审开始的时候，今天的庭审其实很简单，就是公诉辩护人的名字叫做 Jennifer Hodell。他要求啊，就是这个辩护人的律师，他要求本案呢、尽快的进入审判流程，尽快。但是呢，公诉人这方面他就提出了动议呢，要求庭审延期到12月下个月啊，12月1号延期，估计就是希望有更多的时间准备，对吧？有更充分的准备。这个事件大家都还是很清楚的啊。这是11月9日下午啊，中国留学生，我们非常优秀的留学生郑少雄，他在芝加哥大学校区啊，54街900号那里，900社区那里被枪劫，中枪身亡，被抢劫死身。第二天下午6点钟。这个嫌疑犯就被警方逮捕，很快呢就被公诉方以6项证明起诉，3项是一级谋杀，包括蓄谋杀人、故意伤人致死、抢劫致死，还有1项持械抢劫，还有非法使用武器等罪名。所以11月13号，法庭呢就对被告人是否可以进行保释进行了第一次庭审。法庭的当庭判决要继续拘押，不予保释。所以今天的实际上是第二次开庭。第 就是开庭的，就是开庭的时间很短。我们看到了被告人在 Zoom 上，我们看到了这被告人，我们看不到这个凶残的凶手，他有任何的悔意，他的脸上我们看不到他的表情有任何的悔意。所以在伊利诺伊州，如果一级谋杀罪如果成立的话，他被告人将面临20年至终身监禁的刑期。伊利诺伊尼在11年以前就废除了死刑，而且现在美国大部分州都已经相继废除了死刑，所以终身监禁应该是最高刑期了，就是最严厉的处罚。所以我们华人社区来讲，我们的华人留学生来讲，我们肯定要求给这个凶残的罪犯最严厉的惩罚，而且他也这也是他应得的。现在的这一阶段呢，还在初期阶段，这个案子还有多长时间呢？现在还无法评估预估，因为法院呢还要就证据、刑期、陪审团等等各种这些问题啊，都要进行审理和裁定。这个案子呢，郑少雄同学被害案呢，激起了我们华人社区的极其强烈的反响，不仅我们芝加哥，全美的华人，啊，全美的华人，还有包括我们国内的，叫我们同胞们，对吧？所以大家非常愤慨，非常愤慨。你像郑少雄24岁，对吧？风华正茂，仪表人才，非常聪明，对吧？就是在短短的一两分钟，他就倒在血泊中。所以他的遇害呢，也其实也给我们大家都敲了一个很大的警钟，就是说这种事情一不小心都会落到我们每个人头上。所以我们呢，在要求市府、要求学校要强化保安的时候，我们自己也要勇敢的站出来，是吧？要呼吁，是吧？要对加强对我们亚裔、对中国人、华人的保护，也要求市府和芝加哥大学采取进一步的措施，要保证我们的学生的安全。你看这个事情啊，今年以来，这学生呢、啊，芝加哥大仅就芝加哥大学来讲，学生就有3次被枪杀事件，其中2起都是我们中国学生，所以非常令人痛心的。那我们中国这些学生来芝加哥大学留学的都是非常优秀的，是吧？而且父母啊，其实很多家庭的环境友好的，但是也有很多环境一般的。他们为了孩子能够到这么名牌大学来读书，他们实际上他们倾其所有，所以来了以后也是希望他们，对吧？希望他们能够今后能够报效社会，对吧？也能够有一个美好的前程。但是呢，你想一下子就断送了，所以这非常令人惋惜。所以我们肯定是强烈谴责这个罪犯的恶行。我们同时呢，我们自己留学期间，我们同学啊，我们也要加强自身的保护。我们的华人社区也是一样，我们通过这件事情也吸取教训，我们也要保护我们的社区。你像前几天在中国城，我们大家都提出来口号，要保护加拿大，保护中国城，也就是对我们华人社区要保护。为什么要保护？就是它不安全嘛，它经常不有这种各种刑事犯罪事，这种案件发生，所以我们就要呼吁，是吧？呼吁这个政府加强和这个警察部门要加强巡逻，加强措施，啊，加强这个保卫措施。同时呢，我们自己也都要行动起来，要保护我们自身，保护我们的社区，保护我们的同学群体。我下面呢，也接着讲讲呢，就是我们在这里是吧？我们入乡随俗，我们应该怎么来保护自己？啊，怎么来保护自己？怎么来实现？特别是我们留学生来讲，我们怎么来实现平安留学？怎么能够在 美国异国他乡，我们能够安全的完成我们的学业，是吧？能够学成，不管是留下来还是归国啊。所以，我首先讲讲，因为我们同学嘛都很年轻了，是吧？都很年轻，而且很多人也都是第一次来到美国。所以第一次来到美国以后，我们应该怎么做，是吧？我觉得首先呢，我们要入乡随俗，要了解一下美国的法律，基本的法律体系和制度，了解它的，对吧？跟我们的学习，跟我们的生活有关系的一些基本的法律常识，我们应该了解一些这个。别讲21岁。以下不能酗酒，对吧？等等，不能这些常识，我们要注意，对吧？不要因为一点点小事就被警察逮捕了，对吧？这是我们要在然后学校，你看学校它也每个学校都有很多这种安全呐、指南的这个 guideline， 所以我们要去一定要呢要尽快的熟悉这些东西，来了以后。不要把一些东西都 ignore 了，忽视了，因为美国大学跟我们中国大学还是有很大的区别的。我们中国大学同学啊，新生啊一入学，你学校里面呢马上都要组织新生的各种各样的会议，然后呢学校的所有的新生都会被组织起来，有班呐、啊。有这个班级啊，有各种干部啊，都得到配置，所以你每天上什么课，什么时候做什么，你基本上都心里都非常有数的。美国大学它是不一样的，譬如讲你进了学校以后，你很多情况下你都是要自己啊，要能够料理自己，所以你要经常的要看看学校发的各种各样的 message， 学校都会给你发的，对吧 ？guideline 啊 ，email 啊。告诉你什么事啊，你学你的课是怎么安排啊等等，所以我们自己一定要看，不看的话呢经常啊为一点点小事啊给自己啊造成一些很大的麻烦。我们在这里做有些 case 就是这样，你看我们有的 F1 学生，他在学校以后，学校里面要求入学以后你要登记啊，你上哪些课，有的是上网课，有的是往下课，有的网上课，你一定要看看学校发的 email， 跟你对网上网下这要求是怎么样。我们有的同学就是因为忽视了这一点，结果呢就把这个学生身份呢、很快就学校说你这没有符合法律规定，我们把你的学生身份停止了。你讲个特别，我们千辛万苦我们来到这里，对吧？就是因为这个登记学校的事情，对吧？我们可能就把我们的学生身份暂时终止了。你要是想恢复起来要花很大的劲，花老鼻子劲。所以这些东西呢，我觉得我们来了以后入乡随俗，对吧？就是要搞清楚，对吧？要把学校的一些基本的规章制度我们自己要搞清楚，特别是跟我们自己的切身利益有关的，譬如讲你的身份，对吧？你的身份，你的学业啊，你的一些这些东西呢，我们一定要把它弄好，对吧？一定要把它弄好。再一个呢，就是我们来了以后的，
郑德兄 ，you are muted。郑德兄，你的麦克风给关掉了。
好了吗？
行了。
OK， 对，我们呢在这里平安留学啊，我就讲，我们就是要了解一下这个，就是还有呢，我们就了解一下美国，它的警察局的一些制度，对吧？因为我们在美国的，其实很多人呢、都跟警察呢都会打交道，譬如讲你要在开汽车。你很容易啊，你要如果超速，你或者是因为 因为超速啊或者抢道啊，很有可能就被这个警察来叫停，是吧？所以美国这个警察体制呢，我们其实呢也得了解一点。你像美国的警察呢，跟我们中国不一样。我们中国呢，它有公安部，相当于一个中央机构，各省的公安厅呐、市县呐、是公安局。美国呢，它这个公安体系，美国这个警察体系呢，它是跟它联邦制度有关系的，所以它这个全国呢有10000多个公安局，啊，全国有很多公安局。你看这，而且呢，他们都是平等的，不管大城市小城市，他们这个体系都是平等的，对吧？所以我们都是平等的，而且他们是在有些案子里面呢，他们有配合，对吧？譬如讲我们在这个郑少雄同学发生的案发，我们前天啊，我们昨天我们跟华联会的一些侨领呢、啊，我们去现场看了一下，对吧？案发现场。那个地方呢，你就可以看到，我们当时还看到有同学啊，我们中国有同学还在那里送花圈的，对吧？还有人去送花，送花的、宣花的。所以那个地方呢，就在接近了大学跟市区的这个边界上。所以这个里面就是说，他们这个学校警察和这个市区的警察，他们是怎么来这配合的？我想他们是肯定是有一定的他们的规矩了，对吧？怎么来循环的？但是我就讲的话呢，就是说他们这个警察制度呢，他们是相对的，都是各管一块的。所以这样的话呢，他们有时呢有些呢产生一些问题，对吧？也是产生一些问题，因为他们这个在美国啊，这有失踪的人口是很多的。美国的人口始终能很高，我今天还上网芝加哥的网站呢，我就警察网站我还去看了一下，他们最近的都有人口啊始终，对吧？最近的都有年轻人始终，所以他们始终的人马上在网上爆出来，所以这些呢，他们有实力，就是这种警察呢，各个地方呢都管一块，他们有实力可能不能很好的这个协调。但是美国有没有联邦警察呢？美国也有联邦警察，他叫 FBI， 对吧 ？FBI 就联邦调查局，就是联邦警察。所以联邦警察呢，现在呢，很多呢也转移了，也是呢进行的这个配合了调查各种各样的这种案件，对吧？跨州这些案件，他们都来进行一些调查。所以就我们同学来讲呢，我们来美国来的或者了解一点这还是有必要的，对吧？因为呢，经常有时会遇到警察呢，我们平时呢，我们有需要的时候，我们需要警察来帮助，对吧？比如讲我们有任何自己发生了危险，或者你出了车祸，或者自己有什么紧急状态，都应该立即打911，对吧？美国打911的时候，警察啦立即会来的，对吧？美国911立即会来的，这个他们那个体制啊，这一点非常非常非常不错。无论在哪个地方，都是几分钟的时间嘛，通常几分钟的时间警察就到了。所以呢，我们自己呢遇到一些危险，遇到一些不感觉到自己的生命安全呐、啊、有没有问题的时候，我们就马上应该呢报警，对吧？这911，这是我们这，对吧？再就是呢，我们还有呢，我们遇到这个有些呢，譬如讲我们在高速公路上开车碰到警察，对吧？说我们超速，我们这个时候我们不要跟他激烈的争辩，对吧？不要特别不能让警察啦认为你在反抗，这一点很重要，对吧？因为你要警察认为你的反抗，特别是你要手舞足蹈或者在口袋里面掏东西，他甚至可以开枪，对吧？开枪的，对吧？他当然更可以把你逮捕起来了，对吧？所以我们在这方面呢，我们就是要注意，对吧？就是要注意，在特别我们留学生在这里来到美国初来乍到，对吧？不要就是尽量的避免了、啊。发生这种事情，因为你在美国一旦被逮捕呢， 你就有一个记录，知道吧？这些逮捕记录，这逮捕记录你即使你在法庭上啊，你以后被取消掉，但是你对你来讲，你要是对你来讲，你都得有个记录啊，你要想把它取消掉都非常困难，对吧？而且有时候推了很长的时间，所以我们呢就尽量的要避免这种事情发生，对吧？非常尽量避免这种事情发生。现在呢就是美国，在这我刚前面讲过酗酒的问题，对吧？美国酒21岁，所以21岁以下的年轻人不允许喝酒，这是在一州这种规定。美国其他的州也有类似的规定，都是大同小异了。反正一州，你在一州生活的话，你就一定要注意这个，对吧？21岁以下，不满21岁，我们就不要碰，对吧？这是一个，因为这个这属于违法行为。再一个呢，就是我们不要吸毒，这一点很重要。因为美国的这个毒品呢、啊，实际上在校园里面呢，还是很猖獗的，对吧？还是很猖獗的。美国的高中啊、大学啊，有一些吸毒成瘾的人，所以我们来留学的时候，一定要尽量的远离这些人，对吧？我们自己坚决不沾。我们自己的还有呢，就是现在这个网络啊，这个盗窃啊很厉害，信用诈骗、网络盗窃，现在这个在美国啊也是很猖獗的。你看前几天我还听到一个案子，就是有的同学被骗，是吧？被骗，我们中国留学生骗了很多钱。他想不开自杀了啊，就是因为网络诈骗啊，他就听信了这个骗子的这些话。这些东西我们就是对于网络诈骗的东西，因为我们自己很多东西啊，我们如果不清楚的话，我们应该去问，跟同学谈。我们现在好多同学都好像不好意思跟别人说这些事，是吧？特别是自己骗了以后啊，觉得更难受，对吧？也不愿意讲。其实这些事呢，第一个要尽快报警，第二个你要跟同学讲，或者你找律师谈，对吧？像我们都会很快在第一时间里帮助你。所以这些讲的一个情况呢，就是说你入乡随俗，不了解情况的话呢，我们就一定呢就跟我们专业人士联系，对吧？下面我们讲一讲啊，如果我们遇到抢劫我们怎么办，对吧？遇到抢劫我们怎么办？遇到抢劫的时候啊，警察呢也是给我们都基本讲过，他的基本讲过是这，对吧？第一个，人的生命最重要，所以遇到抢劫的时候，遇到我们生命有危险的时候，我们放弃财产。我们放弃我们的财产，不管这财产是你的钱包，甚至是你的汽车，我们都放弃掉，不要因为这些钱财把自己宝贵的生命，对吧？宝贵的失去了自己的宝贵生命，这是我们这个警察反复讲的。然后过后以后呢，就是要立即啊报案，啊，立即报案。如果你记得这些作案人呐、啊，就是犯罪分子啊，他的样子，他是一个什么样的人，对吧？白人呐、啊、黑人呐、啊、西班牙人呐、啊，或者他的身高啊、体重啊等等，对吧？是身高啊，他的年龄，对吧？等等，对吧？性别啊，有你就能够记得多少是多少。我们有的朋友说呢，这个时候啊，你不要记。有的朋友律师朋友说，他说这个时候呢，你不要想着去记这些东西，对吧？因为你要是留意啊，故意留意这些东西呢，很有可能被对方啊盯住，觉得你还是个威胁，对吧？他还加害于你，所以这是这个有的朋友律师朋友这样认为的，对吧？反正我个人认为呢， 我个人认为就是关键看看什么场合吧，看什么情况吧，怎么如果说果真这种情况，这个罪犯他正在留意我们，对吧？我们当然我们继续呢不要忽视他，不要直视他吧，不要让他记住我们或者让他加害于我们，对吧？我们不要故意的去留意他，我觉得这种说法也有他一定的道理啊，也有他一定的道理。然后你完了以后呢，我们一定要果断的报警，啊，果断的报警。然后呢，在如果被抢劫的时候呢，我们自己的身上钱财啊，我们都尽量的尽快拿出来，啊，如果他仅仅就是要钱。我记得我们刚刚来美国读书，那也是30多年以前了。那个时候啊，就听这个当地的人告诉我们，当地的华人朋友告诉我，身上呢永远带20块钱，对吧？那个时候，所以现在呢，我看了一些 guideline 还是这样说，你身上带一点钱，20块、30块、40块带钱，对吧？就做保命用的，对吧？防身用的。所以我们不要反抗。是吧？自己，然后你再就是你也不要随便的掏腰包啊，赶快掏腰包，对吧？准备赶快给钱他。我们要注意的就是，你要是这样掏的话呢，他以为你是掏武器，对吧？可能呢，他先把你干掉了，对吧？所以我觉得呢，就是这个时候呢，都得要小心，对吧？你可以告诉他，你可以把手举起来，或者你告诉他钱在我的口袋里面，你是要我掏还是你掏？你可以跟他说，对吧？啊。所以我们在这个时候呢，就是钱财是身外之物，对吧？我们能一个人是随身能够带多少钱嘛？所以我们要他要什么都给他，因为完了以后我们再报警，所以报警很重要，对吧？我们有的人呢，就是平时呢，就是有时呢，在这个报警的问题上，我们有的华人呢还胆小。哎呀，觉得多一次不如少一次，或者是看到别人被抢劫，他呢也不敢去报警，对吧？就是说担心呢以后要他去上庭作证啊，对吧？被对方盯住了，想到很多，对吧？所以这些东西就会助长啊这些罪犯啊他们的气焰。我觉得呢，我们该勇敢的时候就要勇敢的这些地方，我们该勇敢的时候，我们要出来发声，我们要。对对犯呢、啊，我们要指责他的指控他的时候，我们要一起帮助我们的同胞啊，或者帮助我们其他的受害人，我们要指证他，对吧？我觉得该勇敢的时候，该勇敢的这一地方。这个呢，就是说，这里涉及到就是我们在这个平时啊，还有你在什么样的情况下，你可以喊叫，对吧？如果有人多，我觉得你就可以喊 help， 或者喊 fire， 对吧？有人说要喊 fire 更好，对吧？引起更多人的注意，就是有火啊，是吧？所以这个如果有人的多的情况下，你自己大声的喊叫也是一种保护自己的方式。总而言之，就是说对这个抢劫的问题啊，我们呢就是。不要反抗，是吧？遇到危险的时候，我们不要反抗。但是呢，现在有一个问题，如果有人到你家里来，是吧？或者是你明显的他要加害于你，这个时候我如果不反抗，我很有可能呢、啊、要被他打成重伤，或者甚至被他打死。在这种情况下，我们是可以反抗的，哎，这种反抗叫正当防卫。正当防卫，有人到你家。抢劫你，拿了枪或者拿了棍棒，准备加害于你。你这时候有武器，有枪或者有其他的一些棍棒，你可以打他，对吧？你也可以反击他，哪怕把他打成重伤，把他打死，你也叫正当防卫，你没有法律责任，对吧？这是正当防卫。当然，如果你防卫是否正当，还是跟你这个防卫的这个程度很有关系的。如果一个小偷是吧，偷了你东西，我拼命往外跑，对吧？拼命往外跑，你这时候从背后拿一枪把他打死，这估计就防卫过度了，对吧？ 所以这个防卫呢就是程度要相当，是吧？所以你不能够防卫过度啊。这就是我们现在的就是讲讲一些常识吧，就是我们在这里平安留学也好，我们在这里作为华人来讲，我们在这里生活来讲，我们怎么来有效的保护自己，是吧？你比如讲我们在晚上，是吧？你像我们大学里面除了本科生好多学校都要求住 dorm 以外，其他的研究生都住在校外的，住在校外。所以住在校外的时候呢，有时呢你下课啊或者晚上回家了，都得要一个人走啊，或者是很少人在一起走。所以我觉得我们尽量的要避免的单独行走，是吧？尽量的结群嘛，结群一起走，或者是搭学校的车，因为每个大学里面都有学校的班车的，是吧？都有大学的班车的。还有的是很多学校有，就是你只要打电话他们就有专门的车来接你的，你要感觉不安全。我觉得这些也很重要，少一个人单独走。再就是你在走路的时候啊，尽量呢在一些照明的地方，是吧？美国嘛跟中国比，毕竟人口少，是吧？毕竟人口少，所以你像很多地方啊，它的街道你经常晚上都没人的。所以这个时候你要走路的时候呢，你还是在这个灯光下，对吧？不要选择一些避黑暗的地方你走路，对吧？你黑暗的地方可能有坏人的就隐藏在那里，对吧？把你抓，把你那个了，或者把你骗了，把你绑架了。再就是如果你走路的话，在路上走，有时候晚上行人不多，但是有车道，这时候你的车道的时候的走呢，就是尽量的你要背的两条道嘛，对吧？一边左一边右，对吧？尽量都有，你要尽量，你如果说车子从左边过来的话，你要尽量走右边的道，这样的话你可以看到这个车长过来的，不要让这个车子尾随你。因为有时这个美国的这个有时啊，这些抢劫犯啊或者一些坏人啊，他 kidnap 你，他就把你拖到车子里面去了，对吧？这也有的。所以我们这点也得注意，就是走路的时候要注意这个方向。这个呢，我们始终的时候要留意周围的情况，始终要留意周围的情况，不要和陌生人呐、讲话，是吧？不要和这个陌生人呐、肩并肩，是吧？他要跟你搭讪的时候，尽量不要搭讪，是吧？眼睛不要看他，要加快步伐走掉，是吧？这是保护自己的。因为，再就是呢，我们尽量的不要搭便车，是吧？这一点很重要。美国呢，以前的 hitchhiker 很普遍，是吧？大家这个路上啊，要有一段距离走不可能，是吧？就是在路上拦车，是吧？就路上拦车。现在呢，各个警察局啊都不太鼓励大家打这个便车，不是没有熟人的车，大家不要鼓励，是吧？特别是有些人开车子来，给你 offer， 给你个 ride。这个时候我们一定不要上他的车啊，不要上车。所以这一点大家都得注意。这个反正现在其实打车都很方便，有 Uber， 对吧？有 Cab， 有 Uber， 有 Lyft， 都很方便。所以我们就花点钱，我们不要打便车啊，不要打便车。因为或者打公交啊，是吧？坐公交啊等等，就是不要打便车。再就是呢，我们现在这个 AirPods 啊是非常流行了。我们戴这个 AirPods 的时候，我们要小心，是吧？我们不要最好呢不要两边啊，两个耳朵都塞着。你要走路的时候，啊，戴一个耳朵其实就可以了，对吧？戴一个耳朵就可以了。这样的话，你可以观察了旁边的情况，对吧？听到旁边的情况，不然的话你如果两边都戴的话，有时经常呢，搞不清方向的。对吧？就对你的周围的情况啊，你的观察力啊就不行了。还有呢，我们就是自己啊，在这个贵重物品的时候啊，我们要注意。我们现在留学生嘛，现在国内的经济发展了嘛，所以我们很多人家庭呢还是比较富裕，或者你即使说不是那么大富大贵，但是我们来的时候有些名牌东西我们都会有一些，对吧？有的是名牌汽车， 有人民卖手表，或者是我们的贵重的这个衣物，或者是贵重的皮包等等，这些东西呢，我觉得呢，我们还是要注意。尤其呢，就是假如说你一个人单独走路啊，或者单独行动的时候啊，不要落户，对吧？不要落户，不要成为这个坏人呐、啊，这个盯找的对象。这些我觉得很重要的。另外，我们前两年我们芝加哥听到很多关于这个加拿大加拿大 Goose 这个衣服啊被抢劫的这些案子有很多，对吧？有不少。所以我觉得我们这点呢要注意啊。再就是我们尽量的随身呢不要携带太多现金，对吧？大笔的现金啊，如果带一个几千块钱呐、啊，是吧？上万块钱呢，尽量的不要做这种事，是吧？如果你非要带不可的话呢，你就可以把它分开，把它分开放到不同的口袋里面啊。不要让你显得你的口袋里面呢孤孤单单的很多钱，是吧？不显得孤孤单单很多钱，所以这一点呢，就是贵重物品啊，就是现金呢、啊，你不要带太多啊。再一个呢，就是谈 ATM machine， 对吧？美国的 ATM machine 这个取款机啊，我们大家如果你提现金，你都得去那个地方取款。美国的所有的 ATM machine 里，它是基本上都有摄像头的，对吧？都有摄像头的。但是呢，即使这样，它也还是很难，经常呢无法组织啊，这个坏人呐、啊，他来对你行窃。所以我们在走的要去这个 ATM machine 的时候呢，我们一定要注意，尤其晚上的时候，是吧？一定首先要看到周围的环境安不安全，不安全我们就不要去，对吧？如果周围环境安全的时候，我们也都要。四边都看一看，是吧？看到比较没有什么杂人，在这种情况下，我们可以去进那个 ATM machine。ATM machine 最好的方式呢，就是他们有小隔间的，对吧？这样显得比较安全一点。如果你在路上有个 ATM machine， 你就过去以后，啊，如果晚上没有行人的话，这样的情况呢，尽量的还是避免，是吧？不要去，是吧？等等。再就是这个车子的事情啊，车子现在呢，这个车子啊，劫车子的事故呢，也在这个芝加哥啊，也是频繁的发生，是吧？频繁的发生。如果你开一辆比较好的车，被坏人盯上了，是吧？被坏人盯上了，他们就会想方设法把你的车子劫住，把你的车子开走，是吧？在这样的情况下呢，所以我们一定要注意呢，我们无论到哪个地方去呢，我们还是首先观察一下地形，看看情况。然后呢，我们如果我们暂时要停止，我们等一下走的话，我们一定要把车门锁上，啊，一定把车门锁上，这点很重要。如果你要是真的被罪犯盯住了，或者你要没有锁好车门，他把门打开了，拿着枪逼到你。这个时候我觉得你乖乖的就从车里面跑出来了，是吧？把车子给他，然后自己选择尽量的 peacefully 离开啊， peacefully 离开，这样呢以免自己啊被打或甚至被 kill， 是吧？因为一辆车无论它多贵，它也没有你的生命贵，所以这一点我们一定要注意啊。所以我们讲的就讲了很多很具体的这些东西，对吧？就是在美国你来了以后吧，入乡随俗，要注意安全，怎么自己平安留学，怎么在遇到抢劫遇到坏人的时候我们应该怎么办。其实这些东西呢都是常识，学校里面警察，对吧？像我们大家也是不断的跟你们讲，我觉得我们今天讲一讲呢，也给大家加深印象，加深印象呢，自己在行动当中呢，也会自己在平时行动里面呢，也会对自己的有所帮助。我最后讲一讲呢，就是从郑少雄同学被害案里，我们就看出了，就是啊，我们呢 华人的这次空前的团结啊，我们华人这次在很短的时间内捐款了、很多钱，对吧？我是以前没见过的，像华人啊，在短短的三四天的时间内，就大家啦，就是献出自己的爱心，对吧？捐了很多钱，而且我们自己也不断的有朋友来跟我们联系，怎么赚钱，怎么帮助他们，等等。所以这一次呢，就是显出啊，我们这个华人这个团结和我们的力量。所以我觉得在这个方面呢，我们华人呢，其实借这个机会呢，我们应该呢，就是要想办法呢，要提出我们的诉求，对吧？我们就是要对芝加哥啊这些环境，尤其是我们 Chinatown 啊，像芝加哥大学啊这些地方，对吧？我们要加强啊这个措施，我们要呼吁学校，呼吁市政府要改善，对吧？要改善，要改进，要下大决心整治，不能就这样一直就这样拖下去。你看我们芝加哥每年有六七百个人被打死，对吧？没有六七百个人，芝加哥只有300多万人，纽约有800多万人，我们芝加哥被 kill 的人数超过他们。所以这些东西呢，都我们中国城啊这个地方啊，也是一个其实也是个比较混杂的一个地方，对吧？虽然它非常繁荣，我们芝加哥中国人非常繁荣，但是呢，也是经常的有这种罪犯啊出没。所以我们这方面，我们一定要呼吁啊，要政府啊要采取措施，对吧？要采取措施。我们你像前几天这个芝加哥大学的学联，他们就向学校提出了非常详细的建议书，改进这种治安，是吧？所以我们华人社团，是吧？华联会其实都可以推个这个领导作用，也要发出这种呼吁，是吧？发出这种倡议，我们应该强烈要求。惩罚这个严惩这个犯罪分子，然后加强啊警力，保护芝加哥，保护我们华人社区，保护我们的华人。我就讲这些。
非常感谢黄律师啊，讲得非常好。那讲了很多就是特别有用的一些方式方法，就希望大家都能够从中学到一些东西。那我这边有几个问题啊，给您提，而且是我看到很多的咱们这边听讲座这个朋友都有提到，就是关于说这个防卫的问题哈，到底就是什么情况下可以防卫，可以反抗，什么情况就是反抗到什么样的程度啊，就自己是没有法律责任的。就是对这个您再稍微给拓展讲一下。
对，现在就是我刚才讲的正当防卫的问题，是吧？正当防卫的就是这，假如说你我个人就是觉得你就是说你要遇到情况，就是说有坏人来加害于你啊，要对你造成致伤致残或者是致死这种情况，而且你没有退路，无路可逃，这种情况你是可以反抗的，对吧？在这种反抗的过程当中，哪怕你把对方打伤甚至打死，一般来讲啊，你是无罪的，这就叫正当防卫啊。所以我不知道我解释清楚了没有。假如说你说我们两个朋友或者我们两个路人素不相识，在路上发生了口角，哎呀，我打了你一下啊，你这时候非要跟你推撞了一下，你说这个时候我非要狠狠地打我一下，是吧？把这个事情升级，是吧？你说这要正当防卫，这些东西呢，就是说我们就是要就事论事，是吧？一般来讲呢，就是避免呢、跟人呢、发生冲突或者斗殴，尽量避免，是吧？因为任何很多事情就是一走了之了嘛，对吧？不会造成什么那个，是吧？自己退一步嘛，海阔天空，是吧？我讲的这种情况呢，就是说一定是自己的生命，是吧？自己的身体生命，是吧？安全受到严重的威胁的情况下，我们可以反抗的。我们这应该是这个度，对，好吧？
那就是还有一个问题啊，就是咱们这边有好多学生的家长在听， 那么就是他们就想呢，就是为了自己的这个孩子的安全呢，就是说是不是应该随身带一些这些保护自己的一些东西啊，比如说taser 啊，或者是 pepper spray 啊，或者尖锐的这些东西，就是有家长提这样的问题，是不是就是说万一遇到紧急的情况下可以拿出来保护一下自己，这方面有什么需要考量的或者注意的事情吗？
我觉得是可以带的，你随身带一些防卫的东西，对吧？比如讲你遇到坏人的时候，美国这商店都有卖的嘛，对吧？这些保护自己的这些，它就是特别是女性，对吧？你打那个什么胡椒水啊，这些啊，你喷雾啊，你防止这个对方啊靠近你，对吧？这些东西当然是可以的，但是你自己一定要掌握，你就是你不要随便怀疑别人嘛，对吧？这个人没有这个恶意，对吧？你就喷别人一下，对吧？我觉得这些就是你随身可以带一些，对吧？如果你要是有这个持枪证，甚至有这个隐蔽持枪证，你可以随身携枪的，甚至可以，对吧？当然，你看美国的持枪，它是分有 license 不一样嘛，对吧？它一个就是你可以买枪放在家里面，像我就有枪，但放在家里面。我现在至今呢还没有这个执照，但是你可以带着随身呢、可以带枪的一种执照，他们叫做 concealed gun， 对吧？就是你那里可以带到身上可以防身，对吧？但是你要拿着这个执照，你要去上课啊，我现在还没有时间去上课，所以我觉得是可以的，你甚至可以拿枪保护自己的，
好，这边还有一个在就是我们的 email 上收集到的问题，黄律师，他说如果呢我在公共场合里遇到别人言语或肢体上的侮辱，比如种族侮辱，是否可以适当的进行肢体冲突反抗？总感觉到受侮辱还得考虑怎么样保护自己，才不会侵犯对方的违法法，去侵犯对方，实在是件窝心的事儿。这是一个。我们也对，看看你有这方面有什么建议吗？
这种建议就是说，如果有人说我们，对吧，用侮辱性的语言骂我们中国人，对吧？中国人像 China man 啊 ，key chin 啊，对吧？像这些东西都是一些侮辱性的语言，对吧？或者是称我们 yellow， 对吧 ？yellow， 这都是美国上政治词，都是一些很敏感的。你都等于是种族歧视的语言，甚至有人骂你，对吧？有人甚至骂你，骂我们。但这种情况下，你说我们应该怎么办？我们去打吗？我觉得是不肯定不适合的啊。你看你在什么场合？假如说这个人就在街上就说了一句，你说我想 fight back， 那是你的 choice， 对吧？但是你说我能不能报警？我觉得这完全看情况，对吧？如果旁边有警察，你可以叫这个警察来。你说我专门打个911，因为这个人骂了我一句，我打个911，我不觉得你是不是那个一下。当然，你可以告诉他，你这是侮辱性的语言，你是 racist remarks， 对吧？你可以告诉他，这是种族歧视语言，你可以告诉他。那你看嘛，对吧？我觉得是这样的。总的来讲呢，我是。个人认为你不要因为语言的冲突啊变成了肢体的冲突，不是因为他因为骂了我可以打他，我合法了。我觉得那真是警察来的话，你打人的你要先负责任，是吧？这一点我们要注意。
好，我这边还有两个问题啊，我快速问一下。这问题呢就是有他说有一个学生问的，他说作为一个学生。如果我遇到一个人要钱，怎么样区分乞讨和抢劫？怎么样判断是可以拒绝的，还是直接就给，就说给钱这样子？
那其实我们大家很容易分辨的嘛。要我们华人在美国生活，每天对吧？那个乞讨人他一般都要的钱很少嘛，他一般要的 give me a quarter 嘛，对吧？要一个 quarter 对吧？或者要最多要一块钱嘛。对吧？所以他们很少要你要很多钱的。你要是抢劫的人，他会跟你说你把钱拿出来，否则的话，这个我会惩罚你，是吧？他会这样讲话的嘛，是吧？所以我觉得这肯定是情况的，这种情况很容易分清嘛。我想我们在座的很多华人， 我们大家都在这里生活几十年，对吧？得碰到这种乞讨的人很多很多，所以都知道谁是乞讨，谁是抢劫，对吧？这我觉得这很容易分清的。
好啊，那最后我再问黄律师一个问题哈，就是因为刚才呢，就是其实那咱们刚才里面有英文的时候也讲过，就是费城发生的地铁上发生的这个案件哈。啊，我看到就是咱们听众很多人都在讨论这件事情。那就想您再给讲一下，就是在这种公共交通上面，就如果发生了这样的被就是遭到了这样的袭击，那就是我们怎么样保护自己呢？或者是说还有就是说更进一步，就是我们怎么样防止这种事情发生？然后如果发生，我们怎么保护自己？
对，在公共交通工具上，地铁上、公共巴士上，你发生这种事情的，你现在来讲，你说我们怎么保护自己？如果我们这个身强力壮的，对吧？你觉得你可以跟对方那个一下，他如果这样加害于你，你肯定是可以反抗的，是没问题的。但是我们有很多人没有那么强壮啊，对吧？你要跟他反抗，你可能是要遭更大的罪，对吧？这个时候呢，我觉得一个就是，如果能有可能尽量报警，对吧？有可能尽量报警，或者你就高声喊叫，对吧？或者你就高声喊叫，吸引其他人的注意，让大家来帮你。美国见义勇为的人还是很多的，对吧？就这个时候，我觉得还是应该需要其他的人来帮助你啊。嗯，这些东西啊，我个人觉得啊，完全就是具体情况。看每个具体情况，你要采取不同的措施，具体情况具体分析。你说哪有什么一刀切的东西呢？对吧？这个人在地铁上或者公共交通上打我一下，我必须还他一下。这你没有这样的没有这样的 guideline 的嘛？没有的，对吧？所以遇到很严重的加害情况的话，我们能避的尽量避。我们避不了的时候，我们如果能够反抗，我们就反抗，是吧？我们能够反抗，但是我们尽量的就是引起其他人注意来帮我们，然后我们能够打911，要尽快打911。对啊，这我给的 advice 是这样。
嗯，好好，刚才那个我记得我们刚才好像有别的嘉宾讲到，就是说尽量上车了以后，尽量不要坐在一个没人的角落里，就是尽量坐在这个司机旁边，或者是多的地方，这个大家要多注意。对，好，那我就是我觉得这个我们问题今天问的差不多了，那我交还给汪理事长，看看就是说还有什么要总结一下的。
没有总结，你结束吧，你结束。
好，那特别的感谢我们黄律师哈，今天给我们的分享的这些内容非常非常好，非常非常有用。那我们呢就是考虑时间的关系啊，我们已经两个多小时了啊，大家的因为反响特别强烈，所以我们就多花了时间提一些问题。如果还有什么问题没有回答到的，大家可以在事后发给我们。今天包括对话栏里的问题，我们都会收集起来。就是转发给今天我们的所有的嘉宾，能够把问题收集回来再发回给大家。我今天呢就是我们今天的讲座呢就差不多到这里了。那我想代表我们今天所有的主办单位，包括呢我们伊利诺伊库克郡的警长办公室、华联会、科工专，还有美国华人联合会伊利诺伊分会以及芝加哥大学，感谢所有朋友的参与。那也特别感谢我们今天所有的嘉宾，感谢你们的专业建议，感谢你们对华人社区的支持和帮助。那么我们希望呢，就是我们能够一起共同努力，保护我们自己，也让我们自己的家园更加安全。就是跟大家再讲一下，我们今天讲座的录像呢，会上传到我们的 YouTube channel。如果有今天没有能够看到我们今天这个讲座的人呢，可以随后到 YouTube channel 去观看，希望能够有更多的人从中受益。好，那么我们特别特别的感谢大家参与，祝大家都能够健康平安，我们下次再见，感谢。
谢谢大家，
谢谢你，
谢谢你，谢谢大家，谢谢黄律师。
对。